Good morning, everyone. This is update for July 3, 2022, day 130 of the war, end of the day update. So we're going to do a little bit of a general sort of strategic discussion, then we're going to discuss our LAN 10, and then we're going to do walks through the front line as we always do. So let's first discuss, let's go back to agriculture. As we're saying, it will be important, and the sort of situation there has not been resolved so far. So what we learned is that Russia has been using a lot of seeds from let's say from Europe, and that's a part of the reason why Russia grew so much as exporting powerhouse in terms of grains. And those seeds from Europe, they bought 30% more productive that relative to the seeds that are brewed in Russia, or like not brewed, probably not the right word, sorry. You will correct me, I'm sure, in the comments. But essentially, those seeds are much more effective. And then now with sanctions, Russia will not get those seeds. So that really means that the Russian yields, or the amount of the grains produced in wheat, will go down by about 30%. And that really what this means is that Russia will be essentially wiped out as exporting powerhouse, and that not even that, but essentially what this means that Russia will disappear as exporter, because it will return to the position that it has been during the Soviet times, where it was barely self-sufficient in production of grains. Sometimes it actually was importing grains, right? So now then this may happen. So the planting season is essentially in September, October. That's for the fall wheat and some grains as well. And then there is another opportunity in the spring, right? But the best one, the highest yield is when you plant in the fall, because the seed has more time to develop in the ground, the plant will become stronger, and basically the yield goes higher because of that. So if this war continues, let's say, as many people predict, till about New Year, this really means that Russia will not get those seeds, and that will lead to significant drop in production of the grains and wheat. And so we will see probably that Russia will essentially disappear as exporter starting from July of 2023, and probably even could be even earlier, given the whole situation that, you know, Russian government will not react last minute. They probably will institute something starting from probably spring of 2023. Another sort of problem that's sort of related to this is that today Russian ship with Ukrainian grain from Zaporizhia and Kherson region were stopped, and essentially looks like it was seized by the Turkish government, because obviously Russian ship does not have sort of evidence that this is a Russian grain. So it was clear that this is Ukrainian grain, because the ship left from Berdyansk, from this port here, and it has been known that Russian authorities, they collecting grain from this area, and more to say expropriating grain from this area, and they loading on that ship, right? Probably was going to Syria or something like that. So it was effectively seized by the Turkish government. So what this really means that Russia also will not be able to fully utilize the potential of the territories, that Ukrainian territories that it captured, because what this really means, it needs to blend this Ukrainian wheat with the Russian wheat and then sort of export it. And that really what this really means, that this Ukrainian wheat needs to go to all the way far to the Russian port Novorossiysk. It's on Black Sea, it's down south there. What the problem with that is that the transportation cost will be very significant, because it's pretty big distance, especially for Kherson region, and as well as the Zaporizhia region quite a bit as well. So this really means that the price that's being paid, if it is being paid, we're not even clear, because it might be simply expropriated. And right now, we're pretty certain it's probably expropriated. But let's say if this is more normal relationship, right? And you know, your Russian government essentially buys it. The price at which the price at which the Russian government buys this Ukrainian wheat has to be dirty cheap. And it really means that the farmers will not be incentivized to produce, and they will probably produce just barely enough for their own needs, essentially, right? So this is for probably what's going to be happening as well. So what this really means that Russia probably will be gone as exporter of wheat, and then also this region will be gone. This region captured by Russia will be gone as exporter. And then internally in Ukraine, we discussed the problem where Ukrainian government increased the cost of transportation by 70%. But again, this is destroying incentive for the farmers to produce, and because it essentially expropriates their profit. It's not sort of like literally taking away, but through the through different means, right? By forcing them to pay extremely high prices for transportation, it's expropriation of their profits. So they will have very little incentive to produce as well. So we may, worst case scenario, what we may see is that essentially Ukraine will be sort of nominal exporter or close to nothing, and Russia could be actually like no exporter to the level that they may actually import something, right? So this could be a huge problem starting from sometime spring 2023. When relative to what we've seen, it may get much worse, basically, to actually literal famine in different places on this planet. We don't even know exactly where. Then let's switch actually now to another topic, which is missile strikes that Russia is carrying out against Ukraine. We don't discuss those, but we would like to discuss something because we think it's just generally relevant and sort of educational and explains what's going on in general in terms of Russian inventory of Russian sort of abilities. And what we is, if you observed past whatever week or so, you have seen that Russian missiles hit more civilian targets than they used to, right? And the reason for that is actually that Russia started using more and more old Soviet missiles. They called X-22. They actually were designed to hit like military ships to destroy. So let's say you have a fleet of ships, and then you send those missiles, and they pick the largest ships and destroy them. That's the idea behind those missiles. And they were developed in like mid 60s, early 60s. So there's no GPS, no advanced electronics. It's super primitive, and the way it actually hits the target, it actually has kind of like radar that seeks out large contrast targets which with large signature, and that's usually huge amounts of metal, right? Because the ships, it's all metal, right? Steel and so on. So what they really target, like they designed to seek out huge metal objects, right? And so let's say you have a big fleet, it seeks out the largest ship and hits it, and presumably largest ship is the most valuable, so you kind of satisfy the need to, you know, you meet your goal, right? So essentially the missile decides on its own what sort of target it's gonna hit. It's not directed by radio waves or anything. It's just like super primitive missile in many ways, but it was sort of sufficient for the task, right? So if Russian military using these missiles to hit more ground targets, so what happens is specifically there was that attack, there was that situation when Russian rocket hit this shopping center in Kremenchuk. This is this city here, and destroyed it. And what happened there is that modern shopping centers, they essentially used they being built from basically steel frames, right? They have huge steel frames from steel beams, and that's how they being built. So that's it's like the idea was is to quickly build them, right? And so because of that missile sees that huge pile of steel and thinks this is the sort of large ship, and it hits it, right? Because it actually was aimed at the, it's not even military factory, but like machine building factories, it was not far away. But then because missile decides by itself which target is going to hit, and it seeks out, as we discussed, their largest pile of metal. So that's why it hit that place. So this is what's really happening with all of this missile situation. And then what this also means that the missiles that Russian military was using before, which were caliber, they were essentially out of inventory of those missiles, or extremely low on it. And the production, and they basically using everything that's sort of built, they're using it directly from the factory, right? So and the production capacity is about 240 missiles per year. Maybe they brought it, so that really means like it's like less than one missile per day, right? In Russia used to, you know, to send about at least 10 missiles per day. On some days it could be like as 20, 40, 50, 60. So very large number of missiles. So it just really means that at this point, most of the missiles will be those Soviet old X-22 from the like so large Soviet inventory. And that really gonna mean that there will be more probably civilian targets that's gonna get a hit or affected, whatever you wanna say. So that's a situation right now with this whole missile and with this caliber. That's essentially at this point is to great extent probably will be out of the picture, but doesn't sort of change the situation for better, because you know the sort of this old missile is actually in many ways much worse because it's less precise, let's put this way. Now let's actually start, let's look at the Arlan 10, and let's revisit this UAV and why it's such an effective and deadly weapon. And essentially it's a secret, or sort of, well, open secret, why Russian military is able to do what it does in terms of squeezing Ukrainian military and effectively slowly but surely capturing territories, Ukrainian territories. So let's actually review. We had a video a long time ago, about 2 months or more, about it, and we had some more information in the meanwhile. So let's review the technical specs so that it's going to be a little bit easier to understand what it is. So first of all, it was developed quite long time ago, 2006 to somewhere in 2006 and 7. Its first use in military operation was in the Russian war against Georgia in August of 2008. So that's where they saw their first sort of action. In terms of the size, their UAV is relatively small. Wingspan is only 3.1 meters and the length is about 1.8. So it's, you know, it's close to the human size. I mean, size, not really big. The payload is 3 kilograms and the weight is 18 kilograms. And the hull is made from composite material and specifically carbon plastics, especially wings. What this really does is that carbon plastic is sort of called stealth technology, so it's invisible for many radars, and that really makes this UAV relatively hard target to detect in the first place. It's actually relatively easy to detect because the engine is gasoline and it's very loud, so you can just kind of like hear it by its noise if it's low enough. But if it's very high, then you're not gonna hear it. But however, even though the engine is very loud, it's actually also advantage and strength of this UAV, because it's actually gasoline engine. And what it really means is you don't need to recharge batteries, you don't need to think about batteries, you can just put the gasoline and it flies. It's first thing. So the other thing is that it can fly for a really long time. That's probably will not be achievable for the most electric motor UAVs. And the third thing is that it's It can fly in a cold temperature, so it can the temperature can go as low as minus 30 degrees Celsius, which is going to be pretty much unachievable for the most electric motor UAVs, or achievable, but then they're not going to be able to fly as long. So there is a lot of constraining problems with this, with choosing electric motor as your engine, basically. And what this means, that you know, flying at minus 30, this really means that they can be used during the winter without any problems. And especially if you understand, if you go high, even like 1,000 meters above ground, 1,500, it gets colder there, right? So really, it actually is important factor, the temperature, specifically negative temperature, for UAVs and their ability to execute their tasks. So as you can see, also the flight duration is about 16 hours. So this is probably one of the longest we know. We haven't seen any electric comparable UAV that can do that. We have seen like Ukrainian ones, and their technical capabilities are definitely worse than this one. In addition, this UAV can transmit the signal in protected form for up to 120 kilometers. They don't really fly that far because they support this 152 millimeter self-propelled howitzer STA-S, which has 47, the length of the barrel is 47 calibers. So, and they shoot about 30 kilometers. So they really don't need to fly that far. But you know, as you can see, the flying, 10, 20 kilometers is not a problem. And that's, they hang over Ukrainian rear at the distance of 10 to 20 kilometers in the Ukrainian rear. And they're seeking out high value targets, right? Such as, you know, M777, self-propelled howitzers, you know, Krebs, this German PH2000s, or multiple rocket launching systems, both Soviet and the ones from the US, HIMARS. So it's, you know, they seeking out or a command post. Sometimes they also seeking out tanks. So they designed for this high value targets. They're not seeking out, you know, soldiers or anything like that. That's not their goal. The goal is to destroy heavy weapons. And essentially, that's a backbone of the defense system of any army, Ukrainian, Russian, or whatever, any other army. And then, you know, once you destroy the backbone, then the rest is just mopping up operation for the troops. So, and then, so let's actually continue, finish it. And the cost of this UAV to Russian, this is what Russian military pays, is about 100,000. The actual cost to sort of manufacture is about, the whole is about less than 10,000, let's say $6,000-$8,000. The equipment, you know, depending on obviously on equipment, could be 10,000 to 20,000 to 30,000. So this UAV doesn't cost more than 40,000. In most cases, it's between 20,000 to 30,000 US dollars to manufacturing cost, right? Obviously some profit. And you know, it's obviously very highly profitable for the manufacturer of this UAVs. The production capacity is 200 to 300 per year, and as we discussed, they were being manufactured since at least 2008. So Russia probably has a relatively large stockpile of this. The only thing is that when we say 200 to 300, they're being used by sort of Russian government, not only in military, but in many other sort of areas, for like their Ministry of Internal Affairs uses them for geological services, for the firefighting, especially in Taiga, where it's a remote area. So it's being used in general in many sort of areas, and that's why sometimes we saw that they have that that some of the shot down our lands, they were not from the Russian military, but let's say from Russian Minister of Internal Affairs or something, or firefighting units or things like that. So basically they essentially looks like they're being pulled from other sort of owners of those to help Russian military, right? So that's and then final sort of not thoughts, but on their technical specs is that, as you can see, it's being launched from the catapult, and then the way it lands using the parachute, right? So that really means that they don't have the runways or landing strips or anything. They can be launched anywhere, which is exactly what you need in the military, and then they can land anywhere. The final piece, and a very important piece of information that you can see, it's basically disassemblable, modular. So what this really means, it's extremely easy to repair them, right? You can cannibalize, you can even pick up, you know, destroyed UAV that got damaged, and you can use those spares to keep your other one running, or you can assemble from, you know, three or whatever number of broken ones, you know, their sort of working one. And that maintainability is extremely important for the military in the field. That really means that they're gonna pretty much can operate non-stop at any time, right? And that's a significant advantage. Not to add to this, there was actually, when it was designed as an engineered product, it was intentionally designed in a way that components are easily replaceable. So for example, you can see here this one has engine Saito. It's a Japanese manufacturer. Russian got them by basically smuggled them through China, but it doesn't need to be Saito. You could put anything that's sort of similar characteristics, and you can connect it, plug it in, and it's gonna work. So it's in a way like, you know, the system plug and play, right? So you don't need to have exactly, you're not tied up to this specific manufacturer, and this goes true for everything, for electronics, for literally everything in this plane is you know, can be sort of, you know, changed and replaced, and you can put different manufacturer. It heavily relies on commercial equipment, so essentially they don't really use any, like, you know, military grade equipment in this. It's all commercial, so which really means it's extremely widely available. You can easily smuggle them, even if, let's say, sanctions, and you cannot get it, let's say, the Saito from you know, not from Japan, but through China. You can get something like no name Chinese manufacturer. You can put it in easily and it flies, right? So you don't need to re-engineer to adjust anything. Just everything is super easily replaceable. That's why some people saw that they use like caps from Coca-Cola bottles to as a cap for the tank, for the gasoline tank in this UAV. And this is that idea. And people see it as sort of some kind of negative. It actually huge strengths. Like, if you can design product like that, that's really this is not a weakness. That's extremely huge strengths. Okay, so now and one last thing is that it can fly as high as 5,000 meters, which makes it unavailable to any sort of personal weapons or any kind of general weapons, with exception of anti-air missiles, which Ukrainian army has right now, handheld, those Stingers, martlets. But, you know, martlets, probably the cost of the missile is probably also close to 100,000. So when you know, it's expensive to shoot them down in the first place, right? And Russia has a lot of them, right? So this really means that it's also very, so you're kind of starting from the sort of negative equation, when usually what it means, it should be very cheap to destroy the enemy target, and it's extremely expensive to destroy this target, right? So that's also another, like, on the plus for this UAV, that it can fly that high. And part of why it can fly that high is because it also has this gasoline engine, right? So So this is in terms of its own characteristics and why on its own as engineered product, it's really excellent product for the job, right? It's, you know, we may sort of joke about those Coca-Cola caps, but they do work and it flies and it, you know, does a lot of damage and it's extremely effective as a weapon. And the other sort of flip side of this is that really means that it's expendable, right? So if the Russian military loses it, okay, no big deal, right? It's cheap parts, you know, we can cannibalize that lost piece of equipment if we recover it or whatever. We can get new ones, so that's not a problem. It doesn't cost, let's say, $1 million or 500,000, for example, Ukrainian army wants to buy also something similar, except they electric, so they in many ways they worse, and they cost about, if I remember, like 450,000 per one. So that's a huge difference, right? The other important part of how it actually works, so as we discussed, it has direct connection with a Russian artillery battery, right? So there is a signal that it sends in real time as it scans the area. It flies and scans the area and it sends a signal to Russian artillery crew in real time. And then it's integrated with equipment on this MSTA, was basically kind of like a iPad, right, for the crew, and it gives you the coordinates. And so essentially their self-propelled howitzer can shoot back almost immediately, right? As soon as it spots the target, the shell starts flying, right? The shortest period of time, it's 46 seconds. And the longest, it's about 1 minute and 15 seconds, if the crews call it lazy, right? So, but in most cases, it's under 1 minute. So let's say if it flies around, sports battery of M777, it sends information immediately, and Russian artillery starts immediately hitting it. And, you know, you cannot move M777 in 46 seconds to new location, right? So that's why it's important that there's a quick feedback loop to the Russian artillery, and it's embedded within this battery, right? So nobody can take it, like, you know, infantry commander cannot take it, nobody else can take it, not only because it's organizationally embedded with the unit, but it's also technically, as you can see, it's integrated, right? It provides only very specific information for artillery to be able to shell the target, right? So it's not that great of use for infantry units, right? So it's kind of like, in many ways, it's a perfect match in this tie with artillery. As a result, this Arlanus effectively provides eyes to Russian artillery, because the way it used to work is, you know, you shoot and you really don't know if you hit the target, right? If it responds back, then okay, you shoot again. So now you have eyes, and the way it works, this artillery shoots first, probably undershoots, overshoot, then, you know, it corrects based on information from this UAV, and finally it hits the target. In case of Russian artillery, it relies a lot less on precision shells, or effectively doesn't really have precision shells almost at all. So it basically saturates the area with artillery shells. So there was one research that shows that it takes about 38 shells for Russian artillery to destroy the target, right? And that they can do that. That's not a problem for them to shoot 38 times before they destroy the target. That's also needs to be understood that when you shoot more at the distance of more than 10 kilometers, dispersion of the shells becomes very big. It's more than 100 meters, probably even like 150, up to, you know, very, 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 very high dispersion. And also this means is, in order to destroy the target, you really need to hit within 2-3 meters, like for sure, right? Or to hit directly the target. maximum 5 meters away from the target. Otherwise, you effectively did not destroy the target. And this is, we're talking about the targets that has like no armor or extremely light skin armor, right? If it's a tank, you really need to essentially hit the tank like straight. Otherwise, it's not going to work. So on average, it takes about 38 shells to destroy. And in a way, it's this, like, Russian artillery is designed to do that, like, to work that way. That's why they have so much, huge ammunition, huge number of shells. So because it's, if this is coming from the Soviet time, obviously, where the victory was designed to achieve by the quantity, not the quality, right? So they, the whole artillery, like the, how to say, artillery system is designed to saturate, right? That's exactly how it was in World War II, World War I, and specifically World War II, where Soviet artillery will accumulate about 200-300 pieces of 200-300 guns per 1 kilometer front line, and it was effectively destroyed the German defenses. And then, you know, they create the breach, and then the tank units go through that breach. So this is how it worked, and that's what Russia is applying right now, except they made it much, much more advanced with the use of this UAV. And so this is sort of little secret how Russia right now gains upper ground over Ukrainian army as a whole by you know, destroying Ukrainian defenses with the help of this UAV. And then, you know, Russian infantry and tanks, they go to mop up sort of remaining resistance, which is essentially, you know, minimal at that point. So hopefully this explains the whole, like, importance, why it's actually, you know, why did this little UAV that's, you know, not made from commercial parts, but it makes a huge difference on the battlefield, essentially. Now let's actually move to the front line, and let's start from the very north, and we're gonna walk in a clockwise fashion. First, we're gonna look this situation along the state border. Situation is the same, no difference. Artillery shelling, no increase in intensity. Now let's move south to Kharkiv. Let's see what's going on there. We have some updates. We, over the past 2-3 days, Russian troops managed to push Ukrainian troops a little bit closer to Kharkiv here in this area, and let's say it's called Supivka area, and then in this area around Verkhny Saltiv. So now let's actually look. First, we're going to look at this area around Supivka. This is what happened here: is that Russian troops captured this village Dementivka here. This is what they captured, and then they also effectively pushed out Ukrainian troops from this village Supivka, and now it's more like a gray zone at this point. Now let's look at the other area where the Russian progress. So if for those who are long-term viewers, you remember that Russian troops attacked from the Staretsa towards Izbytsky, Varvarivka, Ternova. They captured this. And now they also managed to capture this village Rubizhne here. So they effectively control this road and this village Rubizhne. So this is, you know, not huge progress, but we want to just keep it updated so we understand where things are going here on this front line. Now let's move to south again, to Izyum bridgehead, and let's see what's going on here. Situation here is the same, stable, like continuing Russian attacks towards this village of Krasnopilia and Dolina without any success so far. Now let's move to Lysychansk area, and let's see what's going on there. So this is after, you know, Ukrainian troops retreated from this almost a pocket around Lysychansk. This is where the Russian troops at this point are. We don't know actually exact location of Ukrainian troops. They retreated. It's probably somewhat disarray there. We would not be surprised if Ukrainian troops really stopped somewhere straight east of Siversk, not where we're showing them right now here, remains to be seen. All we know for certain that Ukrainian troops still control this village, Ivano-Darivka, and that's where there is Russian pressure towards it. So this does feel to us that the Ukrainian troops probably withdrew all the way to this valley, as many of you corrected, and thanks for the correction, trying to get better. And then what this really means that all of this whole area is becoming, you know, they can do, Russian side can do flank attack, create risk of encirclement, and so this gonna force all of the withdrawal of all Ukrainian troops, also the remaining of the Ukrainian troops here into this valley, right? So that's what's gonna happen, and this is what we discussed yesterday, is not the best sort of option right now, it's not the best defensive position, but we're pretty sure that Ukrainian command will try to hold on to this area for political reasons, because at this point actually Russian troops fully captured Luhansk region of Ukraine, so they fully control Luhansk region, so that's pretty negative politically in Ukraine right now. Otherwise, there was some little pressure here around village of Berestove, but at this point Russian troops don't really need to put any pressure along this road, because they effectively gonna get what they need through this area, and this road especially was very good defensive position, because road has embankment, and you can easily hide on the other side of the road from the artillery shelling, or relatively easy, let's put this way. Now let's move more towards south. Let's see what's going on here near Bakhmut area. We'll just call this Bakhmut area going forward. So Wagner mercenaries were trying to attack, to sort of breach Ukrainian defenses here west of Klinovar. They were not successful so far. No Russian attempts to close this potential pocket for Ukrainian troops at this point. So that's about this for this area. Now let's move more south. Let's see what's going on west of Donetsk. Here situation is essentially frozen. There were some small-scale probing attack directed towards Donetsk International Airport, but as we mean, it's probing, it's nothing really major so far here. Situation here more or less on hold here. Now let's quickly jump to the Zaporizhia front line. It's exactly the same situation as west of Donetsk. It's essentially on hold here. And now let's again jump to Kherson region. Here the same as in Zaporizhia front line, as west of Donetsk, everything is on hold here. For today, thanks for watching, and until tomorrow, bye-bye.